That's great. Up to the Lord for this session. Let's ask the Lord to speak to us, even from His heart. Let's ask the understanding revelation that will bring transformation on our life. Let's pray, God, every question in my heart, every need in my heart, and bring them before you. Answer my questions, Lord, meet my needs. Thank you. Lord, you are more precious than silver. Lord, you are more costly than gold. Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Lord, you are more precious than silver. Lord, you are more costly than gold. Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Let's just tell the Lord that He is the most important person. Even if He has not been, you want to say, Lord, I want you to be the most important person in my life. Lord, I want you to be my priority. Lord, please take over. Change my heart. Change my desire. Give me a driving love and passion for you. Because you are good. Because you are faithful. Lord, I just want to thank you even for this privilege you're giving me to share with your daughters. Father, I thank you, oh God, for these wonderful women into whom you have deposited so much. And you are waiting eagerly. You are itching to harvest even of your deposit in their lives. Father, I pray, oh God, that by the means of your word, through the working of the Holy Spirit, Father, there shall be a harvest in the name of Jesus. Father, they shall become and increasingly become the women you are calling them to be. Holy Spirit, take over. Speak to every one of them. Meet them at their point of need. And together we'll all grow to become who you are calling us to be. We love you, Lord. I come against every contrary plan of the wicked one. I come against every voice of distraction. I come against every voice of busyness of thought. I take authority over such, and I submit from the Amplified. When our sons shall be as plants grown large in their youth, and our daughters as sculptured corner pillars, hewn like those of a palace. Contemporary English Version. Let's pray that our sons will grow like strong plants and that our daughters will be as lovely as columns in the corner of a palace. Praise the Lord. The Bible is telling us here that God's desire is that you and I will be pillars. It's not just His desire, it is His plan. That our daughters may be cornerstones, pillars. Pillar holds a building together. when Samson was going to push down that building, where did he tell them to take him? To the pillars. He takes me to the pillar, the column that is holding this building together. God, in his sovereignty, has determined that you and I, the women, will be the cornerstones, the pillars, the strength of his kingdom. Not just the strength of his kingdom, the strength of our nations, the strength of our communities, the strength of our country. Praise the Lord. So God wants you to begin to see yourself for who he has made you to be. You are not that ordinary woman just, you know, living anyhow. God is depending on you for the growth, for the strength, for the stability of his kingdom. And God wants us to begin to rise to that responsibility. When the pastor was talking about reading Genesis 3, how God put enmity between the woman and the devil, that will tell you that the devil hates us with passionate hatred. And that's why he's always attacking the female gender. From history, he decided, let's silence the woman. Cultural issues came up. It's not just about Africa, it's all over the world. In England, up till now, men earn more than women of the same job, even in the States. Praise the Lord. Because the devil is scared of what God has put in the inside of you and I. And so as long as he can silence us, as long as he can put us down, as long as he can distract us, then he goes on rampage, destroying. Praise the Lord. So God wants you today to begin to open your understanding and eyes to see why there is so much problem in the lives of women. How come women struggle with a lot of issues? Because the devil is out to keep us under. If he can keep us under, then he'll be able to accomplish his plan. But you guys, you've decided to arise and live it loud, and God is behind you. God is excited about it. God is, you know, God is backing you up. God is going to make sure he puts you in that position that your light will so shine before men. Men will see it and glorify God who is in heaven. Tonight, God wants me to tell you, you are made for more than what you think you are. You are made for more than what society says you are. God's plan for you is greater than that which you can imagine. And that is why the devil is so scared and he's fighting us every day. We're in a spiritual warfare. But before you and I can stand up and begin to live it loud, begin to take our place in the church, in the community, in our nation, we must become comfortable with our skin. You must become comfortable with being a woman. Praise the Lord. You must relish and enjoy in your femininity. Growing up, the first thing I hated was being a woman. Amen? Because it's like, man, my brothers had all the privileges. Amen? I come from a culture where men hardly do anything. Amen? Praise the Lord. Men are the kings. So I disliked being a woman. Because I'm an adventurist and I'm a competitor. Do you get what I'm saying? And it looks like I was being put at the background. So I disliked that. The second thing I disliked was where I came from. Amen? In my country, I came from the tribe that was conquered in the Civil War. Praise the Lord. And I was in a school where they always made fun of my tribe. I hated being a woman. I hated being where, you know, coming from where I came from. It had to take God to begin to deliver me from all those things that held me down. To release me to become who he has called me to be. So the first thing God wants you to do is rejoice. Know who you are. Understand who you are. And accept and love yourself for who you are. Another thing I hated was in my family, I was the shortest and I was the darkest. Amen. My skin was the darkest and I was the shortest. And growing up, you know, with friends, you know, I always prayed, God, I want to be tall. I kept praying until I turned 16. Amen. Once I turned 16, I said, I can't grow any longer. But guess what? I grew a little bit taller in my 20s. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So today, you don't allow your culture, you don't allow your color, you don't allow your physical outlook define who you are. I'm going to be very, very practical with us ladies. Amen. We are in a nation where we are the visible what?
Minority.
What are we called? Visible minority. For us to live it loud in this city, we have to, in this nation, we have to be more than excellent. But if you are not confident in who you are, if you allow what people label you to be to keep you down, you would never rise up to the fullest of your potential. Praise the Lord. So the question today is, what is defining your life? You see, another crutch which the devil brings to us women that keeps us under it in the area of relationship. Amen. Some of us ladies, we put our lives on hold waiting for that Mr. Right. Amen. Waiting for that perfect condition. Waiting for that perfect job. But God is saying, this is the time to arise. This is the time to stand up to be who He has called you to be. Be comfortable in who you are. Bible says you are a pillar. Bible says you are special. I'm going to read another scripture, Psalm 45, verse 13. I'll read it from my Bible. I just opened up it. Psalm 45. I'll read from verse 9. King's daughters are among your noble women. Can someone read it from King James? Sorry, please. I prefer it in King James. Psalm 45 from verse 9 to 12.
King's daughters were among the honorable women. Upon thy right hand this time the queen and the gold of Ophir. Happy, O daughter, and consider and incline thy ear. Forget also thy own people and thy father's house. So shall the king greatly desire thy beauty, for he is thy Lord, and worship thou him. And the daughter of the Tyre shall be there with the king. Even the rich among the people shall increase thy favor.
Verse 13.
The king's daughter is all glorious with thee, and clothing is of wrought gold.
That's where I'm going. The king's daughter is what? All glorious with thee. And you are a king's daughter. God is saying you are all glorious within. You are wonderfully and beautifully made. Your physical stature does not define you. Your color does not define you. Your race does not define you. Marriage does not define you. Man does not define you. It is God who defines you. Until we get comfortable with who we are in God, our confidence will never rise. Because the devil is out to keep draining us of the confidence that God wants us to have. He tells us lies about who we are. Tells us lies about how we look. Tells us lies about what we cannot do and what we can do. But today, God wants you to arise, break free from any mental attitude, any mindset that has told you you cannot be who God is calling you to be. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. God wants you to live your best life now. God's call upon your life is to be the best you can be. Today, many of us were allowing our family even to define us. We are allowing the society to define us. We are allowing the devil to define us. But God says, no, you are glorious within. You are perfect in my sight. I made you with a divine agenda. I made you special. The way you act, the way you look, the shape of you, everything about you was handmade. I chose you the way you are. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, what is God saying? God wants you to be comfortable with who you are. Many times, when the enemy attacks us, he attacks us in the realm of our emotions, in the realm of our perception. Praise the Lord. And as long as you are loving him, we find our source of confidence, our source of worth, our source of relevance should be God's love for us. God loves you the way you are. Amen? The way he made you. He loves you. You know, sometimes we're waiting for man to tell us he loves us. Some of us, we're uncomfortable when we're growing older and no man has come. I mean, no one has come to tell us he loves us. You don't have a boyfriend, amen? You don't have a spouse, and you keep your life on hold and wait, you know, until I get married, then I will serve God. Until I get married, then I will pursue that, you know, dream and vision God has given me. But God is saying today, he is the only one who defines. He says, I love you with everlasting love. Anytime you begin to doubt God's love for you, your foundation begins to shake. Amen. Where the theme of this conference, Ephesians 3, verses 16 to 19, he says that your roots may grow deep into God's love. I don't know why I'm talking about this way, but I just sense that some of us are really struggling within us with acceptance, with a sense of inferiority. Praise the Lord. But God wants you to know that he loves you. God wants you to know that what? You are beautifully and wonderfully made. God wants you to be comfortable with his acceptance. Amen. Praise the Lord. And the question I'm going to ask now, do you really feel loved by God? Ask yourself that question. Do I really feel loved by God? You know, sometimes religion has taught us we have to do certain things to earn God's love. Amen? You have to pray more for God to love you. You have to, you know, read the Bible. You have to, if a woman was telling me, I was talking with her, she's having problems with her husband. She said, unless her husband kneels down and prays 2 hours a day for her, then she's not going to, you know, change. It's not, God's love is not based on what we do or what we do not do. It's based on Jesus Christ in the inside. So if you're struggling here with self-acceptance, if you're struggling here with feeling of, you know, inadequacy, if you're struggling with rejection or loneliness or feeling that I'm missing something out of life, God says, I am your fulfillment. If you will open up yourself to me and accept me, receive me as your Lord, your husband, your master, everything, I will fill you up. Praise the Lord. There is that hole in the heart of every man and woman which nobody except God can fill. And as long as that hole is there, there is nothing you can do to fill it up. Sometimes we use things, we try to fill it up with activities. We try to fill it up with friendship. We try to fill it up with sex. We try to fill it up with even alcohol. Today we see it in church. Amen? Nothing can fill that hole except Jesus. Praise the Lord. So for you to to be strong and become the pillar that God has made you to be, you must accept the fact that God loves you and be comfortable with it. And that's the only way we can break through even to our calling. That's the only way we can break through the limitation the devil places over us because of our gender and our femininity. Praise the Lord. Do you really feel loved? Are you hanging on to a relationship that is not healthy because you want someone to, you know, love you? There is a young lady, you know, not too young, I've been, you know, talking with. She's in a relationship where this man simply told her, "I want you as my mistress." Praise the Lord. She is a Christian. Amen? Christian. Amen. And she was telling me, you know, I know it's not healthy for me, but I feel lonely at times. And I really feel he cares for me. I said, if he cares, he only cares for your body. Amen. He only cares. If he really cares for you, he should care enough to marry you. A number of women were sacrificing our virtue on the altar of dating and relationships. And sometimes you get so desperate. You see, desperation gives out vibes to the young men. Amen? When you meet a woman who is desperate for a relationship, it throws off the opposite sex. God wants you to be comfortable. Single, married, in a relationship or not, you are his pillar. He is depending on you for his church to grow and to be strong. Praise the Lord. So let's not hang on to the straw. Let's not hang on to things that will not, you know, that cannot stand the test of time. And God is faithful. Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Every other thing will be added to you. The year I met my husband was the year I told God, I said, God, this year I am dedicating it to you. I'm not going to think about, you know, I'm not going to go into any relationship. I'm going to serve you with all my heart. Honestly, I was busy doing what God wanted me to do, and God brings him along my way. Praise the Lord. Just get committed to the Lord. Just get thrown into the things of God. Just say, God, here I am. You made me a pillar. I really want to be that pillar. In my family, in my church, in my city. Sitting before me are men and women that have great seed in them. Women who God is waiting to wake up and arise and begin to, you know, birth God's purpose for their lives. You know, God gave us womb to birth. Amen? Women were called to birth dreams, birth vision, birth life, birth everything that is good according to God's purpose. Praise the Lord. So we are very, very vital in God's agenda for all humanity. Do not settle for less. What did I say? Do not settle for less. Remember, you're a princess. Remember, you're king's daughter. Remember, God says you are the pillar. In search of love and acceptance, Christian women, we are compromising. Amen. Some of us, we think the way we dress will attract the opposite sex. It doesn't happen that way. Praise the Lord. Some of us think the things we do will make that guy come. I don't know why I'm going to this area, but I'll still go to other areas. But it is not, if you want the person that God has given you, it's not about how you dress. You know, today I see you guys are really wonderfully dressed. Clap for yourself. I hope it's not because you came for the conference. Because sometimes I see, even in church, the way my young sisters dress. And you wonder, what are you looking for? What is it? If you value your body, you want to take care of it, and you want to make it precious. You want to cover up. So I don't know, sometimes we sacrifice our virtue on the altar of acceptance, on the altar of fashion, on the altar of vogue. But God wants you, if you want to live loud, if you want to live it loud, if you want to make a difference, like the pastor was saying, you have to be a peculiar person. You have to swim against the tide. If the world is going this way, you want to go this way. Praise the Lord. You want to go God's way. Let someone say a big amen.
Amen.
Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Your body is a prized possession. You know why the devil keeps attacking us with all kinds of stuff? Because he wants to undermine our femininity. Anything sensual, even they are advertising ice cream, they will show a naked woman. Praise the Lord. You know, he is trying to make us lose our dignity, to become trash. But God wants you and I still here to say no to the devil. I'm going to be different. And I'm not just going to be different. I'm going to affect my generation for Jesus. I'm going to be an example for the younger girls who are coming up to look up to me and say, yeah, this is the model of purity and righteousness. Amen. Another thing the devil attacks us is our relationships. He brings criticism, gossip, disunity, even amongst us. Have you noticed it? When a woman is doing well, who are the people who criticize her the most? Fellow sisters. What does she think she is? What's she up to? And these things break in our rank. But God wants us to know, identify these things, and overcome them. Praise the Lord. So another thing that God is calling us to be, apart from being the pillar, is to be his what? Battle axe. You must understand that you're in a spiritual warfare. And I have noticed it in the scriptures. Whenever there is trouble in the land, who does God call? He calls the women. In the time of Deborah, Bible says people were just walking. There was lawlessness. Who did God call? Deborah, a woman. In the time of Esther, it was a woman. And if you read Micah, can we open our Bibles to Micah chapter 4? Micah chapter 4. When there was trouble in the land, God says, call them. If someone sees it, you might want to read from King James Version. Micah chapter 4 from verse 10 to 13. Micah 4 from 10 to 13. Someone should read, please. Praise the Lord. So Bible tells us that enemies gathered to spy on Zion, the church. And God said, arise and thresh, O daughter of Zion. God calls us to defend this faith. And the most powerful place is on our knees. Amen?
Amen.
God is calling us as women in his church to be warrior princesses. Women who can pray. Women who can discern the times. Women who can take authority over the powers of darkness and subdue them. And you are part of these women that God is calling. But there is so much distraction. If I want to ask today, how many of us sitting here, you have a regular daily time with the Lord? How many of us here spend 30 minutes or more in prayer daily. You know, it's so easy to talk. I want to be, I can come here and say, oh God, this is this is that. But come to the nitty gritty of it. Who is spending time with God? We spend our time on phone, we spend our time on Facebook, we spend our time, how many times, how many minutes a day do you spend in regular fellowship with the Lord? That's the way we will become the warrior Christian. God is depending on you and I. The things that are going wrong in the church, amen? He wants us to deal with it. He wants us to take authority over it. He wants us to pray until there is a change. He wants that situation in our lives, in our family. God is calling us as the pillar to our families. I'll share my personal testimony. You know, I came from a family, my mother's side, everyone, the male especially, they never reached 50. Amen? There was this curse of sudden death in the family. Growing up as a Christian, I was aware of it. Initially, I was scared until I started praying about it and God gave me a word. And I used that word and broke that curse, and that curse remains broken till today. Praise the Lord. You know, let's not take things for granted. You are in that family God put you into for a purpose, as a pillar, as a defense, as a protector. Amen. Amen. You are in that church as a defense. Begin to see yourself today as an indispensable person in that church. If you are not praying, things are going to go wrong. If you are not spending time with God, things are going to go wrong. If you're not praying for your family, for your life, for your society, things will go wrong. You know, I like the theme of your conference, Live It Loud. And it's been coming in my mind, how can we live it loud in this nation where there is so much godlessness? How can you and I make an impact for God's kingdom? Amen? How can we bring the people of this land who have left God back to the Lord? It's by our life. It's by our consistency. It's by our excellence. Most importantly, it's by our prayers. So just know that wherever you are, God is depending on you, sisters. God is depending on me to intercede, to stand in the gap, to bring the change. Any need you see around you, God is opening your eyes to that need because he wants you to do something about it. God is the type when we sit, we are the weaker vessels. You are not the weaker vessel. God says you are what? A pillar. If there is nothing you go out of here with, remember God says you are a pillar, cornerstone. You hold things together. And if you're not doing your job, what is going to happen? There will be chaos. Things will not go wrong. Things will go wrong. So can we say that it's because we daughters of Zion are sleeping that things are going wrong in our land? Amen? Can we say that? Can we say that if all of us sitting here will arise, surrender completely to the Lord and say, Lord, you are the most important thing in my life, most important person. Anything you ask me to do, I will do it. Do you think there will be a change? Do you think there will be improvement? Please, God is calling you and me as the women to arise and thresh. And he has promised to strengthen us. He said, I will make your hooves as strong as what? Iron. God is, I tell you, each time women gather together and they pray, God answers. Praise the Lord. How many of us have experienced that? Each time you see committed women coming together to pray over something, God answers. And that's why the devil constantly fights to divide us. Constantly fights that we can do every other thing but not pray. Constantly, you know, tells us that we can do every other thing but not gather together in unity and pray. So as you go back to your various churches, begin to see yourself in a different light. God is depending on you for the strength of that church, not the pastor. God is depending depending on you for the health of that church. In your family, God is depending on you for the progress, for the good, for the prosperity of your family. And as you're busy doing God's work, God will take care of all your other needs. God is faithful. As you're busy, committed, the Bible says He will not withhold any good thing from those that fear Him. He is a faithful rewarder. But the whole thing is we put the cart before the horse. God, if you do this for me, then I'll do this. It doesn't work that way. Today, God wants you to wake up. God wants us to arise. God wants us to begin to see ourselves in a new light. God wants us to begin to see that we are so important in His agenda that He's, you know, He's like desperate to make us who He wants us to be. And it all starts with a choice. It all starts with a decision. Lord, I surrender. You see, there is that aspect of giving your heart and receiving Jesus as Savior. There is another aspect of receiving Him as the Lord of your life. What does it mean when someone is the Lord? Someone is the master. That person is in control, right? Whatever that person wants you to do, you do it. And the next question I want to ask, how many of us here understand God's call upon their lives as a woman, as a Christian? How many of you sitting, you have the faintest idea of what God will have you be in His kingdom and be for Him? You see, we get caught up in so many things, but God wants women of His presence. Women who will spend time with Him. Women who will wait on the Lord. You know, sometimes we talk about fasting as waiting on the Lord. Waiting on the Lord is, how many of us have gone to the restaurant? You've gone to eat in a restaurant before. You have the waiters. What do they come do? They come before you and say, what do you want? Right? They hang around you. You order something, they bring it. They are serving you, right? So when we wait on the Lord, we're waiting. Lord, what do you want? Amen. God, what is your agenda for today? God, what is your plan for today? What is your plan for this week? But we're so busy. Amen? We're so busy. Always on the run. Some of us, we do our quiet time in the bus. Amen? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We do what? Our prayer time in the bus. Today we're arguing whether we should kneel or stand to pray. You're rushing up. Thank you, Lord. You're brushing us when you're praying. That kind of woman is not going to live on God's call upon her life. Praise the Lord. So God is calling us to be what? Battle axes. He says, you are my battle axe. You are my weapon of warfare. Let's not get distracted anymore. Let's not allow the things of the world draw us away from God's purpose for our lives. Let's get up and know that everything God is doing hinges on our obedience, on our lives. Praise the Lord. I'll now go to the area of emotional attacks. I have talked about it. And also relationships. I know you guys have questions. I will take the questions. But I just wanted to lay the foundation. You see, marriage does not define you. The fact that you have a boyfriend does not define you. One young lady at church, you know, we were meeting, she said, I just want a boyfriend. I just want a boyfriend. And she's been going around sleeping with one guy or the other. Up till today, she doesn't have a regular boyfriend. Praise the Lord. You see, when you put the wrong things as priority, you open up yourselves to what? Temptation. But when you put God first, when you put the things of the kingdom first, when you put your work with the Lord first, God will honor you. So you know what? God is looking for women who will say, yes, Lord, here I am. Use me. Whatever you're doing in this season, don't do it without me. Lord, whatever, if you're winning souls in this season, don't do it without me. Let's begin to dream big for the kingdom of God. Let's begin to dream of what God can use me to do. Let's begin to dream of what God can use you to do. Begin to dream, see yourself being used of God to bring souls into His kingdom. See yourself being used of God to heal the sick. See yourself being used of God to do miraculous things. That's the power of vision and dream. What are you dreaming about? You know, in our church, we're having this Bible study based on Joel Osteen's book, My Best Life Now. And I asked the question, what would you say your best life now means? One of the young men said, I would say, if I had 24 hours to live, what I would do. So if you had 24 hours to live, what would you do in your life? Amen? What regrets would you have? Oh, I wish I had more time. That thing you're wishing you had more time, begin to do it now. Praise the Lord. That thing that probably in future you say, I wish I had done it with your home. Begin with your friends. How many of us sitting here, you've ever shared the message, gospel message with a friend or colleague at school or at work? How many of you? Praise the Lord. Keep doing that. Believe God, God, you can use me wherever I go. You know, one time, that was last year, I signed up, you know, to Curves for, you know, exercises. I walked into the place to do my regular exercise. I had started, you know, I don't know, one of the machines. The instructor was a young girl. And she just comes and stands right in front of me. And she said, which church do you go to? I said, are you a Christian? She said, no, but I'm seeking. Whatever made her, of all the women who came into that church that day, and she wasn't, what amazed me, she wasn't even ashamed or afraid to, what would people say? She walked up to me. And I gave her my phone number and we started meeting. Apparently, she was seeking. She was searching. And over a number of times of talking, one day I witnessed her crying and giving her heart to God. In the gym, at the Curves, wearing my jeans strap. Praise the Lord. God sent someone to me. If we are ready with open heart, praise the Lord. I'm sure someone is imagining how we look. Swimming. All my life I wanted to swim, but I never got the opportunity. I started going, you know, learning, swimming. Praise the Lord. So, wherever you are, if your heart is open, amen, and you're ready, God will send people into your life. But you must have that desire to be used of God. So, that's what really counts. The time is, you know, the Bible says that time is far spent. I tell you, the coming of the Lord is getting closer and closer with every passing day. If you were to stand before God, would you give an account? Thank you, Lord, you gave me this opportunity. I used it for your glory. Why are you distracted? Are we so concerned? You know, thank God for Pastor Olawale. You know, the thorns, the distractions. It's so much, the pressure, it's so much that we're beginning to lose focus. God wants us to realign our focus, our thinking to His divine agenda for our lives. Praise the Lord. So God is calling us as what? Pillars. Number two, as what? Warrior Christians. Number three, God is calling us to be influencers. What did I say? People, women who make positive impact wherever they are and wherever they go. But we can't do these things on our own. Amen? We cannot. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. And how can we get the power of the Holy Spirit? In the presence of God. So God is challenging us today. Let's begin to spend time with the Lord. It takes discipline, amen, to fellowship with the Lord. It takes discipline to have a daily walk with the Lord. Let's spend time with God. Let's spend time. Let's have regular devotion. I see it all over, you know, the place. Young people, they don't know the scriptures anymore. But you and I, especially you, I'm not in your generation, you are the ones who are going to hand over the baton to. And sometime early this year, the Lord was speaking to me. He says, we are in a relay race. Amen? You know the relay, handing baton. When there is going to be a race, the strongest and the best are put in the first leg and then the last leg. True or false? The church of Jesus started powerfully at Pentecost. Do you think it's going to end with, we are in the last days. We are the last lap of the race. Amen? And God is depending on us. All the mistakes that may have happened in between, God wants us to make up for it. But we cannot wish it. You know, there's something I call wishful thinking. We wish it will happen. How will it happen if you and I don't make up our mind to be the people that God will use? Amen? In these last times, to restore the altar of worship, to restore the altar of morality, to restore the altar of positive values, positive influence. God wants you to be that change maker where you are. Wherever you are, there is darkness. Bible says, you are the light of the world. You and I, if we walk into a place where there is chaos, God wants us to be the peacemakers. You walk into a place where there is depression, God wants you to be the joy giver. You walk into a place where there is sickness, God wants you to be the healer. That is what I believe God is calling the daughters of Zion in this end time. You and I sitting here to become influencers, change makers, change bringers, restorer of values, restorer of faith, restorer of worship, restorer of purity. Praise the Lord. Are we willing to step up to the plate? Are we willing to say, yes, here I am, Lord. I'm not going to allow myself to be distracted by all the things of this world, all the things other people are seeking. Lord, I want you, and I want you alone. Praise the Lord. That is what God is putting in my heart to share with you, ladies. And when it comes to that, even in our relationships, God wants us to be change bringers. God wants us to uphold purity. Amen? Purity in our relationship. And when we do that, you'll see God's power working in us, working for us, working through us, and you see us becoming and growing to be the influencers. Another thing I want to leave with you guys is study. Amen? For me, growing up, what helped me grow? I read. I studied Christian books, and I'm still studying. Read. Read about people's lives. Read about people who have walked this way before you, how they overcame, the challenges they faced, how they overcame. Today we're lazy at reading. We'd rather, you know, talk and go on Facebook. God wants women who can spend time, study, not just the word, read books. Amen? Thank God you're here at this conference. Everything you're being taught, go home with it and allow it to change your life. And you see yourself becoming the woman God wants you to be. Praise the Lord. God wants us to begin. Not just to begin. God wants us to defend purity. Amen. God wants us to be peculiar. Our pastors shared it. Different people. It should not be heard amongst us. Amen. Sexual immorality. But it's so rampant. People, you move in with your boyfriend and, oh, everybody accepts it. I work in a place where women come in to buy birth control pills for 13-year-old kids. 13 years already sexually active. And God is calling you and I to stand and make a difference in this dark and perverse generation. Remember, it's depending on you. How can we accomplish this? By the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And how can we do this? Power of His presence. Spend time with God. Be a woman of the Spirit. Be a woman of prayer. Be a woman of the Word. Be a woman of faith. Be a woman of resolute, you know, decision that God, even if every other person is doing this, I'm not going to do it. I will do it your own way. And I know you will bless. Jesus said, what shall it profit a man? What shall it profit a woman if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? What will it profit you, my sister, if you get everything the world is offering you, and then the kingdom of God, there is no reward for you? God wants you to make up your mind today. Where are you going to go with? What path are you going to tread? Are you going to step up to my call upon your life? To be the pillar, amen? To be the cornerstone, to be the warrior woman, to be the change maker. To be the one who will rebuild the altar of righteousness, purity, faith, worship, and power. That's what God is telling us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I really don't feel in my heart to start talking about relationships. I just believe God wants you to get it right. Seek first the kingdom of God. Challenge yourself. If you have not been where you should be spiritually, this weekend is a weekend to just soak yourself in God's presence here. Allow bondages in your life to be destroyed. Some of us are living in the bondage, you know. Pastor Olawale talked about bondage of our past. Amen? Guilt of our past. That keeps you down. Paul said, forgetting those things which are behind, pressing forward. I believe the Lord has dealt with that. So we don't have any more excuse when we leave here. That I will go back, I see myself as the pillar. See myself as the change maker. See myself as the woman who can bring God's will to pass wherever I am. That the glory of the Lord will so fill my life that wherever I go, whether in the gym, whether at work, whether in anywhere, God's glory will so show through me that people will naturally gravitate to. I worked in a place one time, you know, there was one, you know, I'm a pharmacist. This technician, she was always beside me. And one time she said, I like working with you because I feel peace whenever I'm around. You know, sometimes it gets chaotic whenever I'm around. That's what God is calling you and I to be. That without even talking, amen, the glory of God will be. And people can come into your presence. I'll find peace. Are you someone who encourages others? Or are you a discourager? Are you someone who, or are you someone who would put down other people's faith through your murmuring, your complaining, and every other thing? That is not our work now. We are the last lap in the relay race. God is dependent on you. God is dependent on you. And like when I started, I said, I'm presenting 80%. Amen? Amen? The proportion is what? 1 to 4. Isn't it? God is counting on you and I to begin to discover our ministries. To begin to rise up to our ministries. Amen? If you don't know what God is calling you to do, ask Him. Or ask your pastor. How many of us are, I believe you guys, thank God because you are here, you're active in ministry. But there is more to you. There is more God wants you to do. Amen. Don't limit yourself. Don't think, oh well, I've done this, that's okay. Always wait on the Lord. God, what next? What would you have me do? I am here, Lord. What next? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Can we bow down our heads? And after that, if you have questions, I will take them. You are made for more than what you think. I sense it so strongly in my heart that God has been speaking to someone, some of you, and it's like you've had excuses, excuses. You know, Lord, you know, Lord, you know, Lord, when this happens, when that happens. Some of us have put our lives on hold, waiting for that big event, waiting for that big thing. Oh God, is calling you today to arise. He's calling you. He said, I need you. Oh, Mashadi, I need you. I need you. There's something I put inside of you. I want it. I want it. I need it now. I need it now. That power of love and influence that I put in the inside of you, I want it. Is there someone who is going to say, yes, Lord? Yeah, yeah. Lord, I cast aside all the distractions. All the distractions, all the thoughts, all the past, even all the present struggles. You know, sometimes we make excuses. God, if you solve this problem, then I will serve you. But God wants women who will worship him even when they're in pain. Who will reach out to fellow women even when they're hurting. God wants us to live for a cause that is outside of us. Are you going to say, yes, Lord? Yeah, I am, Lord. Use me. Here I am, Lord. Just take me from where I am and take me to where you want me to be. That is God's desire. That is God's plan. Are you going to make up your mind, God? I'm going to be spending quality time with you. I'm not going to play with my work with you. I'm not going to trivialize your grace upon my life. Oh, are you going to release all the hurts, all the disappointments? Even before I came here, the Lord was ministering to me. Someone, you know, you're so disappointed because, you know, there is someone you really thought should be your partner. But that person has gone to another person and you're hurt. God wants you to release that. It's a distraction, sister. It's a distraction. Let it go. Let it go. Someone better is coming. Oh, what is it that you're hanging on to that is kind of tying your feet down? God says, let it go. Let it go. Whatever the struggle is, there is deliverance here today. The Lord is going to break all those yokes. He has even started breaking them. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus.
Like not the first, second, third, fourth, five, six, seven, and they are Christians. So I don't know what God's plan painful it is, but seriously, I don't know what God wants me to do. Because I'm about to tell him, release me from this road. Because I don't know what he wants me to do, and I am tired.
Praise the Lord. Is that similar?
I was like being a Christian is not so easy. I know. Like part of the problem because we are Christian. And I wonder, since when we were small, we were teaching us all this. And I was like, I don't know, is it that people talk to the guys in the church? And I'm confused. Like all of them are just the same. I don't know. In a way.
Praise the Lord.
So you see.
Before that, you know, that brings us again to what God has just told us. We are pillars. If things are going wrong, amen, then we have to do something about it. And it's not a matter of talking and find out. We need to pray to take authority over that spirit. And one thing you have to realize, not everyone who is in the church is a Christian. Amen. Not everyone who is in the church is a Christian. If you hang on to your values, my sister, God will honor you.
Amen.
You'll be amazed. I'll tell you a case I recently, you know, this lady, she, her vow, you know, it's purity. She got, you know, into a relationship with one young man. She somehow sensed it wasn't right, but she hung on to it. But she would not sleep with the guy. One day I heard, the guy was so mad he almost beat her up. They were in the same church, not redeemed, right? So that relationship, she broke it off. Then she started dating another guy who said, oh, you're God sent. And things started going wrong, not because of sex. They both shared the same values. And that's what I want to say. Don't go into a relationship with someone who does not share your values. Praise the Lord. You know, from day one, that will tell you whether that person is a Christian or not. Any man, no matter how he sounds, even if he's a worship team leader, and he does not honor the written word of God, he's not a Christian. It's either he's struggling or he's rebellious, or he's not a Christian. And you cannot mortgage your future. You cannot mortgage your life with someone who cannot wait for you till he marries you. How can you prove that when you guys are married, he will not go after another person? Because he lacks self-control. Being able to say no to premarital sex takes self-control, discipline, and conviction. So any guy who does not share this conviction, run away from something. So this lady I was telling you, when this her relationship was, she was getting, you know, 26 and all that. She was so angry at God. It's like, God, I'm trying to do the right things and it's not working. And God gave me a word for her. God said, you will not be ashamed. She said, she will call me, she's not Nigerian. How would I be ashamed now? Look at what is going on, because that guy had another girlfriend, even put it on Facebook, deleted her from Facebook. Praise the Lord. But do you know what God will do? She got married 2 weeks ago. In fact, my husband and I are the only black people in that church. Maybe they are growing there. 2 weeks ago, July, whatever, 17th or 11th, I can't remember, on a Sunday. Do you know, we went through it. I was meeting with her. Sometimes we will be together praying. And when she comes to church, my kids will just, oh, she has come again. Because they know I'm going to stay long. So God came through to the word. God gave her. And today, she's married to a man who shared her values and who loves her more than any other. God is faithful. Bible says, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you will reap. Not every brother who is in church is a Christian. So the person must share your value. And again, it's not how soon you marry, but how well.
Yes.
Do you get what I'm saying? You can say, oh, I'm time, my biological clock is, you know, passing. you're faithful, God will give you a faithful person.
Amen.
But again, it calls for prayers. Amen. Sisters, amen?
Amen?
Because we're the ones on the receiving end, we need to take authority over this false spirit. It's the spirit of Jezebel, spirit of Babylon, that is polluting the church. It's gotten so bad that even pastors' arms are being twisted these days. We met a pastor friend, you know, in Victoria. I met one of the church members, you know, pregnant and everything. So I said, oh, I saw this lady. She's giving birth. I said, she's married. No, she's not married, but they are engaged. Even pastors are being forced, amen, to bat an eye. But we will not be forced to do that in Jesus'
name.
Wait patiently for the Lord, and God will honor you. God will give you someone who you can go to bed and know that even if something happened to you, you're not looking as pretty as you are now, that person will not look outside. That guy who wants to sleep with you before he marries you doesn't have self-control. And you can't trust him. Besides, the Bible says every other sin we commit is outside the body. But premarital sex is what sin against your own body, which is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And it mortgages your future marriage. It's a spiritual thing. We may not be able to explain it rationally what happens, but it does happen. Praise the Lord. So, such people, they are not worth you. You are the king's daughter. All glorious. Beautiful. You know, one time again, a guy was dating with, you know, they were engaged. In my time, we didn't date. We got engaged. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. Because, you see, dating, someone always gets hurt. Because dating is trial and error. Let us check it out. If it doesn't work, in every relationship, someone wants it to work. And the other person is not committed. Whoever works out hurts the other person. But when you get together with that decision, both of us were going to get married, then it's a committed relationship. Though my daughter tells me dating is a committed relationship, I don't believe that. Praise the Lord. Courtship is a committed relationship. Because you know you're going to, even when you know you're going to get married, you still need to sleep together. That shows self-control. Let's even be practical about it. That shows the day maybe you have backache and you can't give your husband sex, you won't go out and sleep with someone who is all over him. Maybe at work. Praise the Lord. So it's for your own good. God wants to protect us. So be patient. But it's a serious problem. And that's where we come in as warrior daughters. Let's take authority. Not just that this man, a lot of our Christian brothers don't want to grow up. Have you noticed that? And some of them, when they want to get married, they go and marry non-believers or young converts. Have you noticed that? You will expect the brothers, you know, you're all in the spirit with. Then they will go and bring one, so it's something the devil is using it to undermine God's power in the body. And that's why the church is so weak today. Amen. That's why our testimony is compromised. We can't live it loud. Amen. We can't, the church, boast of purity these days to the world. Because what they're doing, we're doing it. And how can we reach them? Well, we can decide here. And one of these girls' fears was that she said, all the serious Christians I've known, they never get married. I don't want to be an old single lady. Okay. Oh, my sisters, they're not really so serious with God. But see them, they're all married. I said, just hang on there. God will honor you. And God did it. And my sister, God will do it. Praise the Lord. And just relax. And you know what you tell yourself? You're not worth me. I'm more valuable than this. Amen. I'm precious. Amen. Another question.
My question is just about this whole purity thing. I think, for the benefit of a doubt, I think we have to draw it down. Because I have this friend, it's not me. She's Christian, she meets the guy is Christian, and then, you know, if you hold body. So it's told that, I said, okay, okay, they said no intercourse, but you know, we can do every other thing. So, what is, because when she was like, but they said, hey, but we're not doing that thing now, like everything else but that thing. And it's not as if, no, I will value you less because I know that's what you save to get married. So, what is it?
Well, it's anything that, you know, when pastor was saying, it corrupts you. Amen. And it always starts with a kiss. Amen. Who is just. Okay, holding hands. But the fact, even Jesus, amen, Jesus said, if you look at a woman lustfully, if you look at a woman lustfully, even when you don't see, what is pornography? There is no physical act, is there? There is no physical act. But it's done. It's done in the mind. There's even what they call telephone sex now. Have you heard about that?
Yeah.
It's all perversion and it's all impurity. So it's not just when you go to the full thing. The process is also impure. Well, can I ask a question? Can it possibly be that we sisters are causing the problem of the brothers? By the way we expose ourselves. And you might not be in church, do you get what I'm saying? But you find out men are very visual. Amen? Men are what? Visual. When they see, it turns them on. Amen? And every day, their minds and imaginations are being bombarded. You see, we should actually pity our young men. Amen. Because even if it's not in church, they go on the street, they see all the, they can't blindfold themselves and they react. And so when they see a lady and the devil tells us lies, you're going to get married eventually. So why wait? So probably it's something we should begin to pray for them, you know, that God will blindfold their eyes. And then let also not be a trap to them. Sometimes the way we dress, I'm sorry to say, our breasts are showing, you think these men are strong? They are not. It's true, you know. You know, we wear all kinds of, you know, let's watch it. Let's do our own part and pray for them. But it's a serious thing. And but don't sell your birthright on the altar of marriage. They are not worth it. Such marriages have poor foundation and they will not last. You don't want to be in an unhappy marriage. Another problem we're having again is the internet dating. Internet marriages. How many of us know about that? E-harmony. There is even Christian mingle. We talked about it on Wednesday again. You know, we talked about it, Mozart and I were talking about it. It's a dilemma, do you get what? Because some people come with really testimonies of success, even in the church. But you know what? Someone you don't know, you can't vouch for. Who is only telling you what he wants you to hear. And it's very, very dangerous. Praise the Lord. But you know what? If God is faithful, I have proved God, I've served God for a long time. In every area I have found him faithful. Even in marriage. Amen. And we pastors, it's a concern because we see ladies in our church, you know. Women will always mourn. And single women, or married, I would say, you know, it's right. But you know what? Marriage does not define you. Marriage should not stop you from going all the way. Praise the Lord. Any other questions? We're going to pray. Wherever these men are, they must come.
Amen.
You know, two, maybe last month, I gave an assignment to a sister at church, you know. I gave her names of a number of sisters. I said, your job is to pray with them until they get married. That's all I want to hear. Praise the Lord. It's that desperate situation requires desperate. I said, get them together. Begin to pray with them until they get married.
When it's so much to get a versus over a 13-year-old. So I can really resonate with that. I work in a pharmacy, right? And under the working to get this one to like take before you get an abortion because she's 16. And at that point my heart just really like said for her, but I just felt like I couldn't do anything. I can't say no, I can't be killed. So in that kind of situation, like how do you live in that, how do you step up, you know, for your generation that is her.
It's, we can't control people's choices, but we can control our choice. For me, in that profession, wherever I work, I make it clear I can't do plan B. Amen? Plan B is the one they use, warning after pill, right? So, and it's there. So I wouldn't do it. And the law, are you a pharmacist?
No, I'm a technician.
Tell them, you know, the law actually requires that moral reasons you can't do it, you can send them to another pharmacy. But if there is no pharmacy around, you must do it anyway. So it won't get to that. It's just for you to make it clear. Sorry, because of my, you know, spiritual convictions, I don't do plan B. Amen. One time someone came, I just passed it on to the next pharmacist. Amen. I wouldn't do it. If I worked in there, I would do it more carefully. So it's one of those things. All we can do is to pray because the system, the society is so godless, but we can still pray and, you know, making our convictions. You see, they talk to us, they tell us how to stop the nonsense they did. Amen. Tell them about church. Amen. When they start talking about the bad things they did, start talking about the fun you had in church. Praise the Lord. The last question.
Okay, this question, so she's like, you've been talking about how, okay, people, you know, don't do it, people, you make your blah, blah, blah. So what about those that have already done, that have already fallen? What's your, I guess, what's the restitution, what's your way of that?
Well, I think Pastor PK handled it, you know. You repent and you don't go. We once had a guy in our church and he was a fireman and he fell into the sin of fornication. Amen. And he comes to Moses, oh, I can't lead again. And Moses said, you need to repent because already you're convicted. And fornication, every sin is sin and God forgives every sin. And when you confess it and repent, don't dwell on it. Amen? For God, every sin God forgives, there is no record of it. Because that's another danger, you know. Maybe when you come to conferences like this, you're reminded, oh, I have done. If you repented once about it, don't keep going for, you know, don't keep on going for prayer. Because that means you don't believe you're forgiven. God forgives every sin. Praise the Lord. So sisters, we're going to talk to the guys today, amen? We're going to talk to them. And if any of them does that thing again, or says that thing, you know that thing? Let me know.
Praise the Lord. Can all the guys come join us up first?
Thank you.
and I quote, this session is for discussing issues. So basically everybody has the free hand to ask as many questions to all the pastors. Pastor Parent is here, Pastor PK is here, Pastor Fatty, Pastor Femi, Pastor Ezra, we have many pastors. So I guess now I'll just throw it out to the floor. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, though. Amen. Alright. So we're gonna change the session a bit. We could just write our questions on a piece of paper and then the pastor will be answering the anonymous. So we'll have about, I guess, 5-10 minutes to do that.